Today I want to talk about something that's going on. See, in September 11, 2001, people had a choice. Over 3,000 people had to make a choice. You see, they didn't have to make a choice of what college they were going to go to. They didn't make a choice of what they were going to wear. They made a choice of how they were going to die. That's a serious thing. If I came up to you today and said, you need to pick the way you're going to die today. The question is, would you reach out for Jesus or would you scream for somebody else? But on that day, they had moments to think. They had to pick the way they were going to die. You know, you can live life to the fullest or you can let go of the anger. 3,000 people are out there. Not one. Because a lot of them couldn't say I'm sorry to the brother or to the sister they yelled at the day before or gave, you know, whatever. What about the people that are in the families and they saw the towers fall? They never got a chance to say I'm sorry to an angry husband or a wife or a child. They were too busy thinking of themselves. I ask you again, what will you do on that day when you have to make a choice? You see, you will never forget where you were on September 11, 2001. Myself, I was driving home from work, and I thought it was a joke on the radio. I thought it was like War of the Worlds, and I was turning it. Everything was on the same frequency. And I stopped at a place, and they had a television, and fire was coming out of that building. I still remember that day, but it didn't touch me the right way. It was just another day. Until I realized people were jumping out of the buildings. The heat was so intense, they had to pick the way they would die. Some of them said, I'd rather die jumping and falling than burning to death. The sad thing is, I have a feeling some burned to death anyway after they fell to the ground. I want to read you what really happened on that day. Here's God talking. God says, I was on the 110th floor in a smoke-filled room with a man who called his wife to say goodbye. I held his finger steady as he dialed, and I gave him peace to say, honey, I'm not going to make it. But it's okay. I'm ready to go. But are you ready to go? God was with his wife when he called as she fed breakfast to her children. He held her up as she tried to understand his words. Then she realized he wasn't coming home tonight. You see, that can happen to any of us at any time. That's the lesson we need to learn. We're not here to learn a lesson about terrorism. We're here to learn the lesson, are we ready to receive God at a moment's notice? Because it could happen to you today, tomorrow, in 5 minutes. But are you ready? God was in the stairwell of the 23rd floor when a woman cried out to him for help. And God said, I've been knocking on the heart of your door for 50 years. Of course, I'll show you the way home, only if you believe in me now. God was sitting at the base of the building with the priests and chaplains, ministering to the injured and devastated souls. God took him home to his flock in heaven. He had heard his voice, and he had answered. God was on all of those four planes. He was in every seat with every prayer. God was with the crew as they were overtaken. He was in the very hearts of the believers there. He was comforting and assuring them that their faith had saved them. But do you have the faith that will save you? God was in Texas and Virginia, California, Michigan, Afghanistan, Iraq. He was standing next to you when you heard the terrible news. Did you feel him? Did you sense him? God wants you to know that he saw every face. He knew every name. He knew everybody. Some met him for the first time on the 86th floor. Some sought God with their last breath. Some couldn't hear him calling through the smoke, "Come to me this way. Take my hand. Choose me for the final time." But some chose to ignore him on September 11th, 2001. But God was there. God did not place you in that tower on that day. You may not know why, but I do, says God. If you were there in that explosive moment in time, would you have reached for God? Or would you reach for man? September 11th was not the end of a journey for many, but someday your journey will end. And God will be there for you as well. Seek me now while you have found him. But then at any moment, you know you can go, but are you ready? God will be in the stairwell of your final thoughts. You see, that's the question. When it comes to push and shove, and you're looking death straight in the face. September 11th, there were people that actually had to say, "I'm going to jump out this window 86 floors and I'm going to die." They know they're going to die. They weren't given a choice of when it was going to happen. Or should I say, if it was going to happen. They were told it was going to happen. But the thing is, our lives are the same way. We're not in 86 floors. We're in life. And I ask anyone who hears my voice today, are you ready to meet God? But you see, you don't have to worry. You don't have to worry. Jesus has come to set you free. Jesus is your Savior. I'm not going to lie to you. Some of the people died a painful death, but Jesus was holding their hand. And right now they're in the hands of God right now in heaven. That plane that crashed and they fought to the front with the terrorists. God was with them the whole way. He was testing their faith. Are you going to accept him even on the last moments of your life? Or are you going to be so concerned you're going to be hauling for the Red Cross, calling for the fire department, calling for the police to save you? Because there's only one person that can save you. His name is Jesus. And his blood is the only thing that can save you today and can save you tomorrow. Not the fire department, not the police, not nobody, no FEMA, no President Bush, Obama, nobody. Jesus is the only one that can save you on that day. But you see, Jesus is always standing there next to you. He doesn't let you go through life without him. I was at a funeral the other day and I was speaking to 300 people or so. You see, when Peter got out of the boat going towards Jesus, he walked on water until he looked around and he started sinking because he was so concerned about him, not Jesus. And Jesus, he hollered and Jesus got him out of the water because he said, "Help me." But you see, some people are afraid to leave the boat. They have to grab onto the boat of the world. They have to grab onto the things of the world. I'm not going to let go. But let me tell you something, church. Let me tell you, St. Cloud, it is safer on the water with Jesus than in the boat of the world. You need to grab his hand. You need to see where you can go with him. Let me tell you something. The boat will sink, but Jesus will never go. I have never seen a boat in my life reach out and save somebody. Do you know if you put a hole in the boat, it will sink? If you put three holes in a boat, it will sink. But let me ask you this. How many holes did Jesus have? He had one in each hand and one in the side, and he still didn't sink. He's still up there. He's alive. He's living. I felt Jesus here today with these musicians, these wonderful musicians. I've been to the transition house, the halfway house. I felt him there. I have felt him in the prisons. I have felt him personally in the jails when there's criminals all around me, and I'd rather stand next to a sanctified, saved prisoner than a jailer, than a guard. I'd rather stand next to him because I know I'm standing next to a man of God, of God. Not of DOC, not of police department stuff, but Jesus himself is in the house. I'm here to tell you, September 11th is just a reminder. It's a tragedy of faith. All the time we hear about God this and Jesus that, but how many people really absorb it? How many people take it to heart? You go there and you see people doing in the military, because there's veterans here. There's a thing called a battlefield baptism. You receive God on the battlefield, but when you leave, you lose him. It was never really a conversion. It was a pill for the moment. God is a pill for life. It's a life-changing thing you do. He can set you free. He can set you free of alcoholism. He can set you free of divorce. He can set you free of poverty. He can set you free of misery. He can set you free. Amen. There's not one thing wrong in your life that he cannot set you free. You look at the Bible, there's not one problem in this world that's not already covered in the Word. Every problem is covered in the Word. And this book shouldn't even be black. It should be red, dripping with blood. Because Jesus' blood is what saved us. You see, on September 11th, somebody had already died first. His name was Jesus. But how many people really accepted him? Let's look at our own lives. Do we truly accept Jesus, or do we carry him in a pocket when we need him? We need to wear Jesus like a parachute, jumping out of an airplane, holding on for dear life to keep you safe. As you're floating down to the earth, you're looking at Jesus up there. You're looking at Jesus all around. You're holding on that parachute. You're not letting go. You don't care if a bee stings you, someone shoots you in the leg. You're not going to let go of that parachute. You're not going to fall 30,000 feet, 10,000 feet, whatever it is. You're not going to let yourself fall. You're going to hold on to that parachute. Let's hold on to Jesus the same way. It doesn't matter what goes wrong in your life. It doesn't matter what goes right in your life. Never let him go. He is there for you. September 11th, I pray that people held on to Jesus. I pray that we all will hold on to Jesus. In my closing right now, if you haven't received Christ and you're sitting in your house today, hearing our voice and a wonderful music of praise from God himself here, and you feel that you're tired of what's been going on, you're tired of the world as it is, you're tired of your problems, you're tired of yelling and screaming, you're just tired. Jesus is standing there, and all you need to say is raise your hand and say, take me, help me, and he will be there for you. You can get on your knees and I'll pray with you right now. Dear Lord Jesus, I give my life to you. I ask you to set me free. I ask you to let me be. Lord, I'm giving you all my problems. Lord, I'm giving you my bills. I'm giving you my depression. I'm giving you my alcohol problems. I'm giving you my drug problems. I'm giving everything to you, Lord. I'm tired of wondering who's outside that door looking at me. Where are the police awaiting to arrest me? I'm tired of the world. The way it is, I want to be in your world, Jesus. I know I'm in this world, but I'm going to be with you. I'm going to be set apart. I'm going to be looking at you. I'm not going to look at the people around me. My eyes are going to be set towards heaven. I ask you to pray that. I ask you to give your life to Jesus right now. And you don't have to go to this church. I just ask you to go to a church that praises God, that reads the book. I don't care where it comes from, because God is all over this earth.